Hello, everybody. Good afternoon if you're in New York. Good evening if you're in Europe. Is it still morning on the West Coast? It's been so great to see so many of you all today. This has been really fun connecting with you virtually. I know you're all excited for this panel, the highly anticipated Pilots Watch, featuring IWC, Bellin Ross, and Bremont. And I want to encourage you, please, to submit your questions while the event is happening so that I'm not scrambling at the end trying to get to all of them. So please feel free to submit those via the Q&A or via the chat. And that way we can collect those questions in advance. I know that you are going to enjoy today immensely. And I would like to introduce you to my colleague, WatchTime Senior Editor, Mark Bernardo.
Thank you, Minda. Thank you for getting this all together. Welcome, everybody, and welcome to all of our distinguished panelists. We're going to be talking some pilot watches today. It's called Flying High 2020, and we have some of the greatest of pilot watch producers in the business here, each with their own kind of interesting story. We have David Seyffer, museum curator for IWC in Schaffhausen, Robert Kolcon, West Coast regional sales manager for Bellin Ross, and co-founder of Bremont Watch Company, Nick English. And we're going to start out with some presentations to familiarize yourself with all of these brands. And we'd like to start with David. We're going to go in order of the company that's been doing it the longest goes first, and we'll take it from there. David?
Thank you, Mark. Welcome all you here in the US watching to this program, and thank you for the invitation. I have to say good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Here in Schaffhausen, it's now getting dark. Presentation about IWC Pilots watches. You know, our first Pilots watch was launched 1936, and I think this is quite interesting to know that we have, if I calculated right, more than 80 years history of Pilots watches, and a lot of, has happened in these decades. So maybe what is quite interesting to know that it was a coincidence, maybe, that it was our founders who actually were pilots. And it happened in the 1930s when the sons of the former CEO, Mr. Homburger, when they went to different schools in Europe to learn everything about watch business. But also, as you can imagine, some young Japs, they wanted to do something else than only learn and do these daily work. So both sons were passionate pilots, and the later CEO, Mr. Hansen's Homburger, we know he learned in London, or he got his pilot's license in London 1933, and he's become a passionate pilot. What we know from some sources, he was not the best pilot at all, but at the end of the day, he was really enjoying flying. As you can see here on the screen, we have his old record book of flights, where you can see when he was, you know, scrolling around with his de Havilland Moth over Sussex and the south west English landscape. But is what is really, really interesting that when he came back from his in training ship, you can say, in London, he most probably convinced his father to make the first so-called pilot's watch, or as we say, special watch for pilot for IWC. And this was not the beginning, not only for pilot's watches, but also, I would say, the first sportive watch in the history of IWC. Before, we were known for classical watches, dress watches, fine pocket watches with high precise movements. This was the reputation of IWC since the beginning. But now with this special watch for pilots, there was something very, very special going on, and it started the tradition. So here, a little bit closer, you see his pilot, his Swiss pilot license. As you can see, June 1936, and this was the year when the first IWC pilot's watch was launched. So I think here it's a little bit small, but this is the dedicated watch I can show you. So this is the special watch for pilots. So, and here we go. This was the start of history. And what is very, very interesting then to see how it developed. I mean, the world history changed. So in the late 1990s, the Second World War broke out. And IWC was then, after the Second World War, supplying the Royal Air Force with Navigator's wristwatch. And the most famous, as you can see, this is most probably the most iconic design and still is very, very important for our timepieces. This is the famous Mark 11, the Navigator's wristwatch Mark 11. And supplying the Royal Air Force more than 40 years, this gave us really the, let's say, the inspiration to go in the 1980s, 1990s for pilots' watches for the civil market. And I can tell you today, our IWC pilots' watches are very, very important for us. I would say it's one of the best performing families of IWC. Yeah, and here we go. I mean, if you look now at our homepage, you will see this really, really iconic timepieces. 2019, we had the famous Spitfire models once again, and with the silver Spitfire, that was to really bring the history of our timepieces into the world of watches again.
Thanks. Thank you, David. Robert, can you tell us a little bit about Bell & Ross?
Sure. Yeah. Let me share my presentation here. Okay. All right. So, as you know, we are a relatively younger company than our friends at IWC and Schaffhausen there. But we do have a history since the brand was developed. So, you know, our tagline has always been from the cockpit to the wrist, which kind of informs everything we do as a brand as far as our design and execution of the watches. So, as you can see, we're very much a design brand. Bell & Ross is, the ampersand in the middle there, but even the logo is a suggestion of a watch. Like the B is the buckle, if you will, with the ampersand being the head of the watch. So it's a little bit fun, but we've always taken it very seriously. So the origins began in 1992 when Carlos and Bruno, who some of you may have seen a little bit earlier today, they combined, they were schoolmates from high school in Paris. And when they came together, they decided to make a watch brand that was based on the design elements that you find on the cockpit instruments of airplanes. Now, of course, things have changed, and aircraft instruments, but we still stay true to those original things that Bruno sort of, as the creative director, identified for inherent principles. So we started off, especially when very, very beginning, you can imagine two guys starting a watch brand. They had to combine with all sorts of different engineers, end users, watchmakers, and they combined all their expertise. So that's actually where the ampersand comes from. The ampersand, it stands for the combination of expertise. It's in the middle of everything we do. It's in the middle of Bell & Ross. And it's basically who we are. So we started off, imagine that they were on the second level at Basel Fair, as it was called back then. And you can see we got some press early on. The first watches were made in partnership with Helmut Sinn, who was always a great friend of the brand and a great friend to Carlos and Bruno. And so that's, and one of the original things was that Bruno was working with Helmut Sinn, and the first thing he designed was an aircraft instrument, the clock for a Nikko jet. The Sinn also had made instruments for airplanes. So the BR-01 is a tribute to that idea in that era, and it's basically the DNA of the brand in one watch, if you will. So those four design principles of legibility, functionality, precision, and reliability are all things that you would find on an aircraft instrument panel. Because you have to be able to read it, it has to work, it has to give you the correct information, and you have to rely on it for your life. So those four design principles really have gone into every Bell & Ross. ever since the beginning, even before the BR01s. So those are the four design principles identified. And like I said, they go into every Bell and Ross watch. You got to read it. It's got to work. It has to have a specific function. If you think about your dashboard of your car, your gas gauge and a speedometer are giving you two different informations, and you really have to rely on them. So same thing while flying a plane. So one of the great things that we've been able to do is partner with different military organizations and armed forces organizations. Obviously, we're based in Paris, so a lot of them are French based, especially, which we're super proud of. And our guest with me today, Emmerich, was a former naval aviator for France. He used to land on aircraft carriers, and he can talk more about that when we get to that part of the program. In 1997, we got capitalization from Chanel, which kind of changed the brand. We started working with them out of Châtelain. So this is the factory in Le Chaux-de-Fonds. And this is where we make everything now. Obviously, you know that we're headquartered in Paris, but all the manufacturing is done here at Châtelain. Like I say, we don't make anything in Paris except decisions. So there we go. So definitely part of the fine Swiss watchmaking world, where we, like I said, assemble everything. The great thing about Châtelain is they're experts in a lot of case making and different materials, especially precious metals and obviously ceramics. So we've been able to take advantage of our facility being one of the industry leaders in ceramics and precious metals and all the good things that you need for watchmaking. So from the beginning, we tried to make watches that were exceptional and to kind of think out of the box. A few examples here. In 1997, the Hydromax. A lot of you may remember at the time it set the record for going the deepest. Of course, we worked with Vincent Calabrese, who did the movement for us in the jumping hour back in 2003. And in 2017, we see our latest one, the BRX2, which was the watch is the movement idea. There's always a concept. You'll notice with Bell and Ross, everything starts with a concept, right? So here is the idea for the original BR0194, some of the early drawings for it. It starts as an idea, it starts as a concept, and then we realize it as we go. So the three collections, which again, we always harken back to from the cockpit to the wrist, the vintage collection pays homage to those watches from the 20th century that were so important to aviators and military types. The instrument, which is our creation from 2005 on, which is the square watch that borrows its identity from the cockpit. And that's really where from the cockpit to the wrist clicked, I think, with a lot of the watch buying public. And of course, the experimental, the BRX1s and X2s, which we stretch our watchmaking abilities and play with materials and really kind of push the envelope, if you will, because even the name, the X1, if we all know the X1 was flown, was the plane that broke the sound barrier by Chuck Yeager. And so he was pushing those envelopes. That's where we named that from there. So in 2005 is when we came out with the BR01. And again, you can see it right here in its milieu. It looks like it just came out of that out of that instrument panel there, which is, I think, very cool. So as always, we've tried to make watches for air, land, and sea. And again, people who are doing extreme professions that need to rely on their timepieces as tools to do their job. So every Bell and Ross, is still made to those specifications. So watch a little video to tell you a little bit about the brand in a nutshell. that's who we are as far as up to date until 2019 when we launched the BR05. So the BR05 is an interesting concept for us. Obviously, we really concentrated on from the cockpit to the wrist look, but we wanted to capture a little bit of different market and idea. And obviously, we came out with a new watch today in that collection, the BR05. So a little story about the BR05. We took that iconic case that really is the pure DNA of the brand, the square case with the round in the square always, right? So when you break it down and you look at the actual design, the round and the square has been our thing for a while, since 2005. We have the four functional screws, which are in each corner, which hold the case together and always have from the beginning. We have that iconic dial that now it goes across all collections, the 12369 Bell and Ross dial. So if we put that together, it would look something like that. And then if we throw on an integrated bracelet, now we're going into a different category than we had been in before. And that would be the integration between the square case and a metal bracelet. That was the idea behind the BR05, to create something that was Bell and Ross, but we're talking in a slightly different watch design and watchmaking vernacular, that of the integrated bracelet into the case. So here is a little video about the BR05. So that's the video that we made. It kind of gives you a really good idea of the watch. Call it the Jewel of Strength. Here it is. Of course, the skeleton version was really great for us as we moved on last year. Still getting calls on it. Sorry, it's sold out. We do have the blue skeletons on the stores now. Then, of course, like anything, you play with the luxury factor of it. Here it is in steel and gold. Here's the brand new blue rose gold piece, which is absolutely gorgeous and stunning in person. But now we come to today, literally today, the 22nd of October, and we are launching the BR05 Chrono. So it's kind of serendipitous that we're here with you today. But here is a video on the birth of the BR05. So there it is, the BR05 Chrono launched today in retailers around the world. But basically what we did is we took that styling that we take that classic, you know, round in the square, rounded it out. Now this case, it's 42 millimeters. So it's a little bit bigger than the 40 millimeter in the automatic that we launched last year. Of course, it comes on the integrated bracelet or the integrated rubber strap. It's a little bit thicker than its contemporary in the BR05 automatic. It's actually 3 millimeters thicker. And as you can see, I love this shot because it really shows the fine detailing on the finishing. Anything that's a flat surface has a brush finish. And then the bevels, anything that's beveled or rounded slightly, gets a polished finish. So it's one of those great things, those great attention to details that Bruno and his design team, and then of course the execution of it at Chatelain is great. We show our 360 degree micro rotor here that goes around, not micro rotor, but full rotor, actually bigger than a regular rotor. And that was especially done for us. And we have, like I was saying earlier, you know, we've always talked about doing watches for extreme professionals. Well, you know, people in the cities, they're also explorers. So we try to make watches for the urban explorer. So as you can see, our urban explorer, he's wearing the BR05 chrono, and then the pilot's wearing the BR03. So kind of nice little integration there. But yeah, so that's the presentation. Thank you for listening.
Wonderful. We fittingly end in a helicopter. Yeah. Thank you, Robert. Nick, can you tell us the story of Bremont?
I'll be quick. I certainly will, Mark. Thank you. And thank you, WatchTime, for today. Thank you, everyone at home listening to these very strange times. And I hope you're all well. I thought I'd give I've got a little PowerPoint. I'll be fairly quick just to tell you a little about our roots at Bremont. Our background very much is based around aviation. It's very much in the DNA of the brand. It's something that's always been there. So that and engineering and the love of watches is what came together really to bring Bremont to life. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna share my screen and hope that this works. This is always, hopefully this, you can see this. I'll just enlarge it and start. There you go. Can you see that, Mark?
We're seeing it, yep.
Perfect, perfect. Well, just very quickly, our background, as I was saying, is very much rooted in aviation. My brother, my father, and myself were all in the Air Force for a bit. All sponsored through university as well, through flying. But our love of flying really came from this chap here, and our love of watches really from this chap who's our father. So my brother and I, so Giles and I, had this real passion for all things engineering. So as kids, we'd spend our time in the workshop with him, making things, restoring old planes, which we still fly, cars, bikes. And one of his passions were clocks and watches. So that's where we got that from. And he paid for his way to university by getting an old clock and making it work and selling it for a bit more. So that's where it started. The other passion, well, one of the main passions, and today is very relevant, is flying. So when he wasn't in the Air Force, when he came out of that, he was doing a lot of display flying. So doing air shows at weekends in various aircraft, from Spitfires to Harvards to, you know, lots of different things. And our form of, again, another form of childcare at the weekends was going to these air shows with him. So we were lucky enough to grow up with this. And then when we were sort of in our teens, my brother and I were doing air shows as well. So we have a fairly good idea in terms of, I suppose, what we felt was needed in terms of flying. A bit of a tipping point of our lives came in 1995, and I hadn't flown with my father for a while, and the air show season was coming upon us, and we decided to go and practice, and my father called my brother up and I and said, look, let's go flying. And we went flying, practiced for an air display, and that day something went pretty badly wrong with the aircraft and we ended up crashing. And sadly he died and I broke 30 odd bones and smashed myself up. And for Giles and I, this was a bit of a tipping point in our lives. And it was this that really got us into watches. We had for our sins, would come out of the university and done a lot of flying there. And we went off and did various careers, but restoring aircraft was one of them. And then it was this point here, then Giles and I said, actually, life is pretty short. Let's go and do something we really want. And since then, flying has been an enormous part of our lives, and it still is. So, but how's this influence, you know, the watches we make? Part of it is through some of the partnerships we've worked with. So we started the brand in 2002. So it's 18 years old. We didn't launch our first watch till 2007. And part of that was, you know, it took us a lot longer to get going than we thought. It was, you know, we're passionate. And I'll show you a picture of it at the end. We're passionate about bringing watchmaking back to the UK, but we did start in Switzerland, and we had a little, a little workshop in Vienna in Switzerland. But it was after a couple of years of that, we started bringing it back. But one of the first partners we ever worked with on the aviation side with Martin Baker, and they make 75% of the world's fighter ejection seats for the Western world. And for them, it was a very interesting conversation. For us, it was too. And they came to us and said, look, we love what you're doing. We'd been going for a couple of years by then. And they said, look, if you can make a watch that we can get, or we can subsidize to give to ejectees, people have ejected from these aircraft. And over the years, that's been 7,600 lives have been saved using their seats. There's an F-35 a couple of weekends ago in LA that went down. And this, they're again using a, on California rather, and they're using ejection seats from Martin Baker. So if you now, so we produce this watch, which had to go through the same testing as the seats themselves. So shock, vibration, everything. And we went along, put these watches on these mannequins' hands through the testing. They were destroying themselves. They just weren't coping. And our technical director at the time, a chap called Peter Roberts, sort of a professor at WASTEP, he ended up designing this sort of movement for our mount for us, where the whole movement is suspended in the case itself. The case was hardened, 7 times more hardened. It became a very technical watch. So the movement was encapsulated in this Faraday cage. Anyway, we eventually designed a watch, the MB, which could be used in these environments. And it was, for us, it was very, very exciting. And if you see now anyone with a red-barreled one of these watches, it means they've survived an ejection seat. We then did a lot of work with Boeing, and that was over a number of years. But one of the most exciting things for Bremont and for, I guess, on the aviation side is probably 25% of our business is military around the world. And that's sort of hundreds of hundreds of different squadrons, again, through, you know, land, you know, from the Army, Navy, and from the Air Force. But if you go to Bremont Military Facebook, you'll be able to see a lot of these things, pictures, and it's great. And this, a lot of this came from the work we'd originally done with Martin Baker and these people, you know, they sit on an aircraft carrier. They're all got the same outfit. They've got the same hairstyle and they're flying the same airplane, but you might have 4 or 5 different squadrons in one of those aircraft carriers. And the only differentiator was often their watch. And that's why pilots and watches, one of the reasons, the modern day reasons, is why watches are so important for military folk. It's an identifier. We do still do a lot with the military and the armed forces. So we've got the armed forces covenant for the UK, which is quite a special thing. We've done a lot of sponsorship over the years and charity work for various military organisations. But one of the things we're most proud of is the partnership with Her Majesty's Armed Forces. So we are their official supplier for watches, which again is quite exciting. And it's all happening here. So, well, it will be in a month's time. So we're talking about this earlier today. This is our new facility in Henley. We're just about half an hour from, or 45 minutes from London, west of there in the countryside. And this is our new sort of 35,000 square feet place where you'll see everything from the bar of metal going in. We've got our new movement, which hopefully the prototypes will be out next year, and all the assembly, all the functions are happening here. And Giles, I did a broadcast with Giles earlier this morning, and he gave a sort of tour around it. But no, that's a whistle-stop tour of our background in aviation. And I think, Mark, it's over to you now, isn't it, for some proper Q&A.
Indeed, indeed. We're going to go around the horn. And thank you, Nick. Thanks for putting that together. So what I love about PilotWise, what I love about these companies are, these are companies that don't just make pilots' watches. They don't just make watches for pilots. They're actually involved in the world of aviation, working with, like Nick said, the military and other such organizations. I want to get into a little bit more of that and start with David. Kind of tell me a bit about what IWC has done throughout the years as far as partnering with military and other such aviation organizations. And specifically, I'd like you to take us to the Top Gun program.
Yes, I mean, this is most recently. I mean, we started to cooperate with Top Gun in the year 2007, and I think we are the only who have the license to use the name Top Gun on our watches. But I think it's very important to say that when I look at the other presentations, I mean, we were also supplier, for example, for the Royal Air Force. And I think what is so interesting with IWC, we were around since 1868, and that, you know, for me personally, I think this kind of partnership with the Royal Air Force. I think this is one of the, in the 40s, we were going for a specification and made the watch, and it was so perfect, well fitting for the Royal Air Force. I think it completely changed in the 1980s, and this is what we want, shouldn't forget. I mean, if we make the statement, the watches are now, I mean, if you are in a cockpit, Mark, we see it in your background, you have redundant systems, you have full electronics, you do not need a mechanical watch at all, I think, if you talk about that. Now the mechanical watch is really for the pure pleasure, for people who love really, you know, the environment back in the days when and you relied on a mechanical timepiece. And I think this is very important that when you put, for example, an IWC pilot watch on your wrist, obviously you wouldn't need it in the cockpit, but you know that you're in the cooperation with Top Gun. I think this is interesting to see, because some of these watches from us, they are still in use. I mean, and some of the Top Gun pilots actually wear these watches when they fly supersonic over the California desert, and the watch is perfectly working, you know. So these are these two pillars, I would say, that are important. First, it's the mechanical tradition, the mechanical watchmaker and the old luxury. But on the other hand, you can still use it when you do this really, really challenging supersonic speed flying. So this is why I think the partnership with Top Gun, and most recently we launched a safety watch for the instructors, inspired for the instructors for the Top Gun school. I mean, so this is what we want to show. Hey, if you are in the cockpit, you can rely on an IWC piece, but if you're not, if you live your daily life, but you want to dream to be a pilot, hey, here we go. Our timepieces are well for that. And we have, like I said, this more than 80 years history of making pilots watches.
Great. Robert, I know that Bell and Ross has worked, for example, Bruno and Carlos have worked actually on designing a plane. For example, are there other areas of aviation that Bell and Ross has dabbled in?
Well, yeah, a couple of years ago, we created a racing plane, basically a prototype racing plane, where instead of wanting to do a watch, just saying, okay, make a watch for a racing plane, we tasked our creative team with making a plane first, and then the watch followed like anything else, right? So it was all part of the whole design process. So they created the plane. We had the prototype, as you can see them in store sometimes. And that was for the Racing Bird, which was part of the vintage collection. But ever since the beginning, one of the first Bell and Rosses, I mean, one of my favorites of all time, the Space One, was made in conjunction for Space Lab back in the day. And we continue to do watches for our aviation partners. And with us as a guest of Bell & Ross is Emmerich. He was a French naval aviator. And for instance, you know, the watch he wears on a daily basis is a watch that we created for the elite pilots who take off and land on aircraft carriers, the Marine Nationale. I'm pretty sure that's the name of it. But yeah, we've gone through the years, we've always tried to work with different groups to create watches for different milestones of the groups, whether it's a special squadron or a special aircraft. We work with Dassault, who did the Dassault Falcon, which is a commercial aircraft. But of course, then they made the Rafale. So we made a watch for the 50th anniversary of the Falcon, and we did a watch for the Rafale, which is the European fighter jet.
And Nick, obviously you had already touched on all of the work that you do with the military, and you have a new partnership this year, correct?
Yeah, actually, talking about aircraft design, it's been quite a fun one. So one of the companies we have a huge amount of respect for here in the UK is Rolls-Royce Aerospace. They've been involved with many record-breaking attempts over the years, ranging from, you know, the first Schneider Trophy record attempts on the water, on the sea, in the Solent, to Thrust 2 when it broke the sound barrier, to, you know, Donald Campbell's powering some of his aircraft boats and things. So there is an amazing history with them, and obviously he's powering the Spitfire and quite a few other. They see, I think quite rightly in a way, for civil aviation, there's going to be a move towards electric. There is, you can see it with the way you know, drones are happening. There'll be people be carrying these passengers soon. These drones will be carrying passengers. They see the future where there'll probably be a sort of hybrid where you'll have aircraft taking off and landing under electric power, perhaps, but getting in the cruise with more traditional combustion engine. So, or jet engine rather. So what we've been doing, they've been attempting to break the world record, speed record in electric aircraft coming out later this year. And okay, with a timing partner, but quite interesting, we've been involved with designing the dashboard for them, but also we've been engineering at our machining facility some of the, for example, the cockpit, some of the escape technology with the hatches and things. So some of the aircraft parts as well, which has been great, great fun. So it'd be very interesting to see how fast they can go. It is the future of aviation, really, certainly for smaller distances. So we're very excited, and that's happening, you know, literally later this year, hopefully, all things going well. It's been slightly delayed with obviously what's going on. But and it's great to be working with them.
Cool. Great. I want to get an answer from each of you, because I've been working on a book about pilots' watches, actually. Shameless plug. It's out next year. All these brands are in it. What I found throughout the history of that type of watch, they're so different. There's very, very simple. There's very, very complicated slide rules and chronographs and world time functions. What I want to start with David and find out, like, what are the essentials of a pilot's watch? And I think I need David to unmute himself.
So maybe we start like it was in 1936. I mean, I told you the story about our founder's family, the Hombergers, when they started to be pilots, and what they really wanted was a pure watch for civil aviation. And we have your pilots on the panel, so they maybe know it better than me, but for example, calculation of speed, you know, or shifter angles and something like that. You think in the 1930s, they were really flying on, it was okay to have the perfect timing. And it's very funny if you see the catalogs of those days when IWC was very, very proud to offer a watch that was reliable and you know, anti-magnetic features like that. But this completely changed then in the 1940s. So I would say for us, for IWC, the most important is the quality of the movement, the preciseness. Of course, we added later in the 1980s chronographs, or let's say in the 2000 and 2007, if you think of our own big pilots with grand, let's say with perpetual calendars. But if you ask me, Mark, essentially, really is the preciseness. And for example, in the 1950s, 1960s, when the Royal Air Force were flying with Mark 11s and the whole crew of, for example, an Afro-Vulcan or other planes were relying on the navigator, Astro Navigator, I think seconds or were very, very important to find the destination. So sorry if I'm repeating myself, but I think this preciseness is very, very important. Other options, I think they are nice to have. And I think this is also a little bit, you know, let's say the demand of today. If you think the pilot's watch is not only for, let's say, the professionals, but it is for people who like flying aviation, like I said, dreaming about pilots and want to have, on the other hand, a cool design, but also this eau de lingerie approach.
Great, precision is important. How about you, Robert? I mean, what is, what to you must every pilot watch have?
Well, I have my opinions, but I'd like to pass this question on to our guest, Emeric Devalas, who's a former, well, he's a pilot and a former French aviator, and he could probably answer this question a little bit better than I could.
Good idea. Hello.
Hi. Thank you, Robert. Yeah, well, you know, I've been in the flying business for over 25 years, and I flew for the French Navy as a fighter pilot for 20 years. And I have to say that the first thing is we need a watch that is robust, that's strong and that can handle a catapult shot and a landing on an aircraft carrier. So when you go at sea for several months, you need to carry a watch that is reliable. So for me, that's the main point. When I go out flying, I need to be sure that my watch is reliable. For a pilot, the watch is an instrument. This is something you have to understand when you go out flying. Even if now we have airplane with screens, touch screens everywhere, you can read the clock anywhere on any screen. But in the end, what you need is your basic instrument, and that is easy to read. If you just take a glance on your wrist, you're able to read the time at any time during the day or at night. It's very easy to see. And that's the reason why we requested a specific watch to Bell & Ross when I was in the Navy. 15 years ago, we asked Bell & Ross to make a very specific classic edition for the French Navy. And not only we asked for a very easy to see, easy to read, a reliable watch, but also with specifics on the watch. We asked for a bidirectional rotating bezel that we use on the carrier. And I think we are the only one to use that on a daily basis when we fly. And also, it's an evidence, but we use the chronograph. Even now on any type of airplane that we fly, it's very common to use the chronograph that you need at some point to take a time hack or a time reference during the flight, even though we have a lot of information in the cockpit. So for all those reasons, a pilot watch needs to meet all those criteria. And also you have to understand that as a military pilot, sometimes we wear a pilot flight suit and later in the day we wear our classic uniform, and you have to wear a watch that match both uniforms.
Versatility.
And also that's the reason why we want a very specific pilot watch.
Okay. Great. Let's go to our other pilot here, Nick. Anything to add to? I know I saved you for last. There's a lot that's been discussed. You must have something to add to this. The essentials of a pilot's watch.
Thank you, Mark. I mean, the obvious one is reliability. There's no point in having a watch which isn't reliable and robust because it's got to work. And I think, that's part of the reason when we started, we only decided to make chronometers. We don't make anything else other than that. So you can have confidence. The other thing for us was just legibility. A flying watch, you can have, you know, very, very fancy chronographs and this sort of stuff, but it's when you're in the air and you've got 50 million things going on, it's really hard to sort of look at a really tiny hand and say, yep, I've got. I mean, it's important for instrument flying. I think if you're doing various things, it is important for sure. But other than that, most of the pilots we work with and the squadrons we work with, they're funnily enough, they're choosing to go more for the simplicity, which surprised me. It'd be more, you know, sort of the MB type watch, which I think just for ease. And that's got a movable internal rotating bezel, so they can do takeoff and landing times and that sort of stuff. But it's other than that, it's about having a watch that you can bash on the cockpit and it still works. It's protected. You're not going to have a massive dome plastic crystal or something like that. You know, it's going to have to be fairly well protected. There's no right or wrong, but I think the fact it's got to be precise work and be able to read are the obvious ones for me.
Great. I'm gonna ask you guys one more, and then I think we're opening it up for some questions from attendees. I actually meant to ask this on the opener, but can everybody show us what they have on their wrist right now? Bob or Robert, sorry.
Sure. Well, this one's easy, given that we're launching the BR05 Chrono. I was lucky enough to score one because I have a couple connections. But anyway, yeah, I'm wearing the BR05 Chrono. I am loving it. I'm just absolutely in love with this watch. I'm going to be sad when I have to send it back. It's really fantastic. So
brand new today.
Yeah, brand new. Popped it out of the box. I should have done an unboxing, but you know, next time. No.
David, what are you wearing today?
So I need the video.
I hope. Try to see David.
Now I can't start the video, so now we should see it. I wear a Mark 18 in a very special version. I'm here a little bit closer. This was a gift by our CEO for 150 years of IWC, and this is why I wear it with big pride, because when we're celebrating 150 years and you get such a gorgeous gift, I mean, this is absolutely great. But it's a pilot watch. It's a Mark 18 with a blue dial, and it's fully inspired by the original Mark 11 asset that is so iconic for us, and I think maybe one of the most famous pilot watches in the world of aviation. And so I'm very, very happy to wear this watch, and it reminds me of this great history of aviation of IWC.
Great. And Nick, what watch do you have on?
I'm wearing a Bremont MB. Here you are. You can see it just about there. But what's quite interesting with Rolls-Royce, we've been testing this new, it's basically a new smart strap that talks to the airplane. It talks to the cockpit through the checklist apps that they've been working. They spend a number of years, the test pilots at Rolls-Royce, developing this app, which, you know, you can use from display flying a Spitfire to flying one of their jets. And it's not only is a checklist, it's also used for airshow apps and it buzzes your wrist and gives you various prompts at various times. It might be changing a fuel tank. It might be an emergency set of drills, but we've been working with them with this app, which is going to be available to pilots, which is quite exciting. So it's sort of a bit of a hybrid, actually, this thing.
Nice. Okay. And I think Minda is going to take over.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Could we see what Emmerich's wearing? Because
oh, yes.
I would love to see his watch.
Okay. I'm wearing this classic pilot special edition. It was designed 15 years ago upon our request for the French Navy for the fighter capability on the French carrier with the bidirectional rotating basal and the chronograph. And I still wear this watch on a daily basis, and I'm very happy. It was a limited edition too, just for the French Navy.
Okay, thank you.
And we actually have one collector question now, and he's posed quite a difficult one, and I'm going to let him ask that live to the panelists now, please.
Is it my question?
Yes, it is.
Okay. So I love your brands, love Pilot Watches. I'm wearing my Spruce Goose from Vermont, not affiliated with the brand. I would like to hear from you in few words, if possible. You all make Pilot Watches. What is it that you have in common with each other? And what is it that you have that is so different? Thank you.
And when he wrote me the question, he said, you have to answer in one word.
Yeah, make it a few words. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I can go first if you like. Do you know, I think obviously the all the brands here, from, we're the youngest brand here, and obviously you know us fairly well, but we were inspired by, Bremont was inspired by both IWC and Bellerose. I mean, there's no doubt. I love the clarity of some of the Bellerose designs, especially the early ones. And I really, you know, in my collection of watches, I've got a Mark 10 IWC, which I cherish. And I think, you know, what I love about those are, you know, the simplicity and the heritage. And I think authenticity in this game is very, very, very important. And I think when you're designing a watch, especially in the early days, it was about simplicity, and it's about producing something which was, you know, you could wear on your wrist all the time, and something that did keep good time. And I think that's where a lot of these brands do have in common. I think if you're designing something which isn't a fashion piece, it's very much a tool watch, then I think you're sort of heading in the right direction. And, you know, I think all three brands are doing that, which is great.
David, IWC?
Yes, I mean, Nick, great word. I would say authenticity, that's the key. That's absolutely key. And thank you for mentioning that, because I think you have your history, Bell and Ross have you have your history, and about what we see in your presentations, and maybe also when I look back at our history, I mean, every watch now from our brands that you can have has got these authenticities. You can prove it via, let's say, cooperation, or you can prove it. Yeah, and I think this is so important, and this is so key. And I think what makes us different, you know, you can call it a fashion, but I think there are some design codes every designer of our brands has to respect, because it's a tool watch, it's a pilot's watch, but there is a certain kind of liberty as in the point of differentiation. And so for all watch connoisseurs and watch lovers out there, that's the point, when they can feel free and enjoy the timepiece that they want with that authentic story.
Thank you. Robert?
Well, I think that the commonality is the design, right? I mean, there's design elements. Like I said, when I was given the presentation, that we went through the design process and identified those elements, the first one being legibility. But I'd actually like to pass this off again to Emmerich, because I know that he's the pilot in the group, besides Nick, of course. But what do you think of the commonality, Emmerich, as far as pilot's watches?
Well, you know, I'm pretty sure that all three brands, IWC, Bremont, and Bell & Ross, are very reliable watches. There's no question about that. But at some point, as a pilot, you know, you when you look into a brand, you get emotional at some point about it, you know, and the watch and the design and style has also at some point to match with your daily job and what you do in your life and the style of your uniform. And I don't know, but at some point, Baron Ross was our preferred choice when we looked into making a watch for our squadron and from the French Navy. And it made sense. It was like an evidence when we looked at the style of the watch, very legible dial, and the simplicity. So I don't know. It's like when you meet somebody, you know, you get emotional, you get a feeling, and that's what I felt with Bell and Ross. And at some point, it's hard to find good words about why you choose a watch or another one. You know, it's a special feeling.
Thank you so much. So I have another question that has come in, and this is for David, but I think it would actually be interesting for you all to answer this as well. At the end of 2019 in the United States, there were over 600,000 active certified pilots. Are airline pilots less attractive than military pilots?
Wow, that's a good point. No, I think it depends. I mean, if any airline pilot would love to have an IWC timepiece, please feel free to join our boutiques and have a look on this great timepieces. As I said, I mean, these corporations like with Top Gun, I mean, that was a kind of a coincidence, but it shows very good, you know, the robustness and the reliability of the watches. But I wouldn't say that if you only focus on such a partnership, it doesn't mean that you want to exclude civil pilots. And if you look, for example, this idea that we or this project that we were sponsoring, the Seyffer Spitfire flying around all over the world, I mean, in 2019, I think this is also a great story. And I guess this is also appealing for all pilots, because this is a kind of a crazy dream that became reality. Flying with a 60-year-old. So please, if you like IWC, well, airline pilots are invited to use our timepieces on their really important daily flights.
Thank you so much, David. We're having just a little technical difficulty with your video and sound. We did hear that. Thank you so much. Does Nick or Robert want to tackle that one?
Yeah, I think from our perspective, we have a huge amount of respect for both. We really do. And I think both military and civil pilots have respect for each other as well. I mean, it's and a lot of the military pilots go off into the civil world. So yeah, we don't really make any differentiation at all. And there's we work equally with both, which is lovely. And I think for us, it's that passion. You know, when you meet someone in life who just has a big passion, and if you meet a pilot who has that passion for aviation, it's wonderful to experience. And as it is with watches, and you get that a lot with commercial pilots, as you do with military. And I think it comes down to an individual basis, doesn't it? You can meet wonderful folk from both sectors, but yeah, we don't differentiate at all.
Thank you. Robert, do you want to go try that one?
Sure. Well, obviously we've done watches, you know, for both sectors, and you know, the commonality is that cockpit to the wrist look. But again, I would love to pass this off to Emmerich, because he's from both worlds, of course, and he can speak to this probably a little better than I could.
Well, it's an interesting question, because I've been flying for the French Navy for over 20 years, and I now fly for the airline. I fly for Air France, and I went from one world to the other. And I have to say that you don't meet the same kind of people. They probably don't have the same connection with aviation, the same feeling, the same history, the same background. In the military, as military officers, we are very sensible or to the you know, the vintage type of instruments, the history about flying, and in the airline business, it's a little bit different. It's more business than a passion. So that's probably a reason why the sensibility of pilots is different from the airline world to the military world. However, the need of a pilot watch is the same in both worlds, I have to say, because I still use my pilot watch even in my airline. So yeah, it's two different worlds, but I think you can find people interested in pilot watches in both.
Thank you. I have one for all three brands, an interesting one. Why has no watch brand ever worked on a watch for helicopter pilots?
We've done loads. We've done lots of different military units with helicopter pilots, actually. So we're from Lynx, from Merlin to Puma to Chinook to, we've done loads and loads. Air Ambulance, based in London. So no, we do, they're a very big part. The Apache boys, we've done quite a few of the those guys around. So no, it's again, a really important part of the aviation world. And again, from military and civil world. So we do, we're heavily involved with both, actually.
Okay, anybody else? Helicopter watches, David?
We do have, I mean, I think it's a reference 3890, and this is also, was offered to a unit from the British Army Aviation for the Apaches, I think. So also for helicopters.
We just got a question in from Dave. Just wondering if your brands have the Test AF, TESTAF certification like the SIN Easy M10. I don't know what that means, but maybe you guys do. David, do you want to answer that?
Yes, we do not have this certification. And I could also not answer what is all what is exactly the specification. Okay. It's not that important that we really meet such a specification. It's more important that you have the watch as such, as reliable, therefore it works and maybe doesn't need that specifications.
Okay. Unless anyone else wants to answer that one, I have a collector asking if all three brands give personal tours of the plants.
We do. And I think we do at the moment, but the new place, the new facility is far more geared up to proper tours. And there we'd be delighted to welcome anyone. And you can see that bar of metal going in, watch cases, movement parts and things coming out. And then the watches being assembled as well. So, and tested. And so from early, obviously we're a bit behind because of what's happening, but from early first quarter of next year, February, March, please, please do get in touch and we'll be delighted to give you a tour. We'll do that personally if you like.
If you come to the IWC Museum, I do it also personally. If you want to visit our manufactory, we organize manufacturer visit. And today, as the situations all over the world with COVID-19, it's possible in a virtual way. So if you like, you have to check with your local IWC boutique to learn more. And one information I got also regarding helicopter pilots, Steve Boulby, who was also flying the Silver Spitfire, is a dedicated helicopter pilot. Voila, here we go. Also that people we have made special watches for helicopter pilots.
Wonderful. Robert, do you have anything to add to that question?
Sure, yeah. Well, you know, we're a little bit split. Remember, the headquarters is in Paris, where Carlos and Bruno are, along with all the teams. And of course, then the watchmaking team is in a little bit of a train ride away in Le Chaux-de-Fonds. So we typically welcome people at the HQ, where they can see all the creativity happening and all the design in the showroom, and they can kind of see a history of Bell and Ross right before their eyes. So we in Paris, we probably welcome more people in Paris, especially since the press, it's a little bit easier to get for people there. And of course, Paris is the number one, you know, tourist destination. So we've arranged for people to do a little private audience with Carlos and Bruno and be able to see everything there. Of course, you know, with COVID, as everyone knows, things have changed. So, you know, one step at a time now.
Thank you. Okay, I have just two more questions. These are all really, really good. What can you learn from the aerospace industry when it comes to building watches? Lightweight, 3D printing, et cetera.
Do you want me to answer? I mean, we've done it with a couple. So we learned a huge amount from, well, two or three companies. One, when we worked a lot with Boeing, it was all about material technology. So working with new steels, new custom 465 steels and titanium. So we've been working with the Advanced Manufacturing Center up in Sheffield, where Boeing were founding partners of Rolls-Royce. And it's all about the type of material they use. So the undercarriage of an F-18, for example, it's this custom 465, which is a very, very hard material. It's very corrosion resistant and very, very strong. It's very hard to machine, but it does make great, great case material if you could be bothered to get into the cutting tool technology. And then someone like Rolls-Royce, I mean, it's just been absolutely bliss dealing with them, because they're also fellow engineers, and they sort of taught the same story, really. And they're passionate, just looking their, you know, attention to detail and the tolerances they're using and what they're doing with 3D printing now, you know, turbine blades. And I mean, it's phenomenally interesting stuff. So I think we could learn a huge amount. We really could. And it's not just about, you know, looking good. They actually have obviously very, very important practical purposes. So we found it very interesting.
Absolutely agree, Nick. I think, for example, that for IWC, when we started to use titanium in the late 1970s, you know, it was also because nobody in the watch industry has ever had experience with titanium or making cases or bracelets of titanium. And the Air Force in airline were really, really helpful, because they had the knowledge about how to, make titanium, how to, you know, mill and drill titanium. And this was very, very helpful. And also with zirconium dioxide, the ceramic that we use. So, the NASA used this in their spaceships, also this material. And so bringing this, I would call it material science, from the aerospace industry into the world of watches, this is really, really helpful. And I think the impact, like you described it, Nick, it's very, very important for all of us.
Okay, Robert, did you want to answer the aerospace question?
Absolutely, sure. So I think, As the two other gentlemen just pointed out, it's you know, it's always about borrowing the materials. You know, as the aerospace industry pushes forward, and we make watches, you know, for the pilots and try to keep up with that. And so I think that the materials are super important, but even the design sometimes comes into play. I'm thinking specifically when we did our watch for the Dassault Rafale, we borrowed the dial color from the actual paint job of the plane. So if you were in front of a Rafale and you had your watch on, your dial would match not only the paint, but the font of the numbers was exactly the font of the stenciling on the plane. So you can borrow it in design, you can borrow it in materials, you can borrow from it in so many different ways, and it all kind of plays together in the end. For just amazing products.
Thank you. Okay, we have one final question for all of the panelists. This comes from Richard, and he said, what is your favorite plane? Mine would be the Saunders Roe SRA-1. No idea what that means. You probably want to pass that to your pilot, right, Robert?
For sure, yeah. I would love to give this to Emmerich.
Wow, it's a very tough question, you know. when I was in the Navy, I flew on three different jets. I flew the French Super Étendard, a single-seat, single-engine airplane, and the F-18 Hornet for 3 years in the U.S. Navy, and then the Rafale. And I have to say that I loved those three airplanes because they are different. And it really depends on the mission that you do and the type of people also that you fly with, you know, with your friends. It's a different ambience. But I have to say that the French Rafale is probably the most advanced airplane, the most tactical, and with a very advanced cockpit. And it's funny to say that in the Rafale, in the French Navy Rafale, it's only touchscreens in the cockpit with one old style chronograph. We kept that chronograph in the airplane, just like I wear my watch every time I go flying, even though it's a very advanced and modern airplane. But again, I would choose the Rafale because it's our newest tactical jet.
Thank you. What about you, David? Can you speak to your favorite plane?
I think we do not have that much time that I speak all of my favorite planes, because I'm I'm one of these nerds, plane spotters, and I really like aviation and planes, but I never made it to be a pilot. So Amrik, you did what I wanted to achieve in my life. No, but to be honest, I mean, of course, now we had 2019, so much to do with the Spitfire. This is for me one of the iconic airplanes because, you know, if you look on the design and how it was made and, you know, it's absolutely great. From the finishing, and I airplanes, for example, the VC-10 flying is ever made, and yeah, and maybe I can name to shorten this these two airplanes as my favorites.
So I guess we will finish with Nick. Thank you, David. Nick, what is your favorite plane?
That's a really hard one. It's a really hard one. I'm sure. I mean, my favorite plane I've flown is the Spitfire, I mean, by far. I mean, that was an incredible thing. And our father used to own one as well. And it was, I mean, it's like strapping on a very noisy, smelly, but very special machine. We've got a company airplane, unlike probably any other company airplane. You think of company jets, don't you? Ours is a French airplane. You'll be very pleased. Do you know the Max Holtz Broussard? So we've got a Broussard, which we fly around and we throw stuff in the back, and that's a great thing. And then we, you know, gypsy moths and things. So I've got such a long list of airplanes I'd love, and my wife despairs. So we'll need a whole nother web forum thing to chat through those.
Okay.
Excellent. All righty. Thanks, Minda, for jumping in with that. We had a lot of great questions there. Thank you to all of our guests and our panelists. We had a fun time here, and keep coming to. We hope we see you at some more WatchTime live panels. And for now, signing off from the cockpit, Mark Bernardo, WatchTime.